Hello everyone, welcome to the another edition of Tech Talks with NASSCOM Insights. This is Ashish Gupta and I lead the products and startups vertical at NASSCOM Insights. Today we gather here to discuss how Indian tech startups are transforming the landscape. COVID has drastically transformed Indian tech startups. Needs have changed and hence business solutions have changed. Solution adoption has changed and as has technology. And this is the change that led to the transformation and increased our focus towards areas like deep tech, sustainable development, cloud native solutions, and digitization. And this is what we are going to focus in our today's webinar to understand the importance and evolution of these important areas. On the behalf of NASSCOM Insights, I would like to welcome Smita, founder CEO of Fandoro Technologies, Prem, founder and CEO at Katonic.ai, Abhishek, Prakash, founder Mtalkz, and Faiz, Mohamed, Haneef, founder and CEO of NeoITO. So my first question is for Prem. So Prem, we have been building some great deep tech products and we all know that deep tech holds great importance, not for the businesses, but also for the economy and for the growth of the country. So when you plan to grow your business, so we'd like to understand that how simple or difficult is to persuade an organization that they require deep tech intervention to grow their business. So can you throw some light on that? How easy or difficult is to persuade an organization and talk to them?
Yeah, Ashish, great question. See, deep tech for people who are probably listening to this for the first time is an umbrella of cutting edge technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, blockchain, augmented reality, and maybe in future quantum computing. So, there's a lot of work which goes into research of these deep techs. And I've been fortunate enough to, be heading blockchain globally for DXC technology. But also during that period, I've done a lot of experimentation using deep tech for many banks. I would have done over 100 experiments using augmented reality, blockchain, AI. And what I realized is that the experiments which actually become successful and really start adding value to the customers are the ones which are business driven. In the end, look, technology means nothing. Most of the businesses have to either get revenue, improve the customer experience or reduce cost. And if your technology is not doing one of this, you're just playing around with it. It's an experiment. Or soon, when businesses realize that it's not adding value, they'll shell the program. I think the key is the focus should always be looking at how do I. So for programs where for engagements where business is involved. There's proper business value defined, business objectives defined, and then you have start looking at what technology can help and start looking at buying those technologies. And sometimes it could be solutions which are driven by those technologies. And when we implement, that's when the success is. On the other hand, many CIOs, they get into FOMO, fear of missing out, and they say, let me implement blockchain. And they start looking at problems and they try to solve with blockchain and most of the time. So it should always be business driven and it should always be outcome based and it should always be the business needs to be engaged from the beginning, and also you need to experiment, show the business some kind of proof of value before you start investing millions of dollars. So, and also see, for many organizations are in different maturity. For some of them, just automating can be easy. So, convincing them to RPA is very easy, but some of them are matured and they're probably looking at deep neural network on AI where they're looking at segmenting customers. So depending on the journey, it could be easy or difficult to convince, but doesn't matter their journey. If the objective of the business is not met, deep technology doesn't mean anything. So with that, I'll pass it back to you. Happy to get any questions if there's any.
No, definitely. We need to understand the journey of the enterprise and try to put your solution try to integrate that solution with their business journey. I think that's the right approach. So. I think, but still, I will say that yes, making enterprise understand that its proper deep tech business value is still at us. So my next question is for Smita. Smita, your startup works in a sustainable development goal space, and frankly, there are very less number of startups in this space. So we'd like to know from you the journey of building an SDG startup, and what do you think are the key drivers of SDG growth in India?
Thank you, Ashish. Firstly, thanks for having us here. Great question. And much like every other startup's journey, our startup journey was not easy either. But I have to say that when we started in 2018, there were not many people. In fact, there were rarely people who would even know what SDGs are. Sometimes, and we still face that those issues even currently. But in past, definitely in 2018, when we started, there were not many people who understood it. We started with the focus on employees. That let's bring individual social responsibility through SDGs. And that was where we started as part of SDGs. And very quickly, we were able to generate bigger interest amongst the enterprises than even the individuals. And we also saw value in actually, working through masses or having a bigger, base to work on instead of just individuals so that we could make a bigger dent on SDGs. And we moved to enterprises, working with enterprises as B2B. Where we realized that large enterprises still work towards sustainability because of regulatory requirements or having visionary CEOs. But when it comes to SMEs or startups, the canvas is totally blank because for a lot of n number of reasons where it's not just about their intent. Sometimes they have the intent, they're lacking on resources, and probably we'll talk later about the challenges there. But we did see a lot of value in supporting SMEs and startups. And eventually, I mean, that was again late 2020s when we moved into this model. And fast forward 2023 today, we are working with, of course, employees, the enterprises, the SMEs and startups, but also investors now. We are seeing a bigger push from the investors for conducting as simple as ESG due diligences before they invest. So currently we are, we've come a long way in these 4 or 5 years, but yes, there's still a long way to go. And if you look at, just to share quick drivers on what are the drivers of SDGs growth in India. So firstly, when we are talking SDGs, it is the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which are a set of 17 global goals, which are very particularly aimed at ending poverty, protecting the planet, and ensuring that all people enjoy peace and prosperity, not just in our country, but globally. Now, very quickly in India, some of the key drivers are, of course, we're seeing economic growth. So India is focusing a lot on actually reducing poverty, creating more job opportunities, working towards access of quality education, working towards access of healthcare for all citizens, particularly maternal and child health. We're seeing India is really investing into infrastructure development, transportation. So, and then climate change is, of course, we are taking big steps towards mitigating them and impacts of climate change. Gender equality is another focus area for us. Good governance is coming up, just to promote transparency and accountability. We're seeing Indian government as well as the administration working towards it. And you may also, when we translate this into the business side of SDGs, you may have noticed a bigger focus from businesses on talking about their CSR, their corporate social responsibilities, adopting more sustainable practices. Most of these Indian businesses are actually, working towards energy efficiency, water conservation, waste management, all of them in their operations. They're becoming more responsible in their supply chain management. We're seeing a lot of impact investing coming up around these areas. ESG reporting, if you may have heard. So a lot of these investment in innovation and technology, collaborations amongst businesses to work towards SDGs. So these are some of the things that we are seeing. And what is really driving them are maybe, government policies, for example, government policies and regulations, not only globally, but particularly in India also. Indian government has implemented policies and regulations to promote SDGs, and many businesses are actually responding to them. You are seeing increased consumer demand. People who are aware of SDGs, aware of our climate issues and concerned about the social and environmental issues, they are demanding the businesses to take a more responsible approach and therefore, leading for businesses to adopt SDGs. There's a certain sense of risk management which SDGs, actually sustainable development, actually brings into these businesses, and also to create opportunities for growth, reducing costs. So that's another aspect which is driving SDGs. We're seeing adopting SDGs also give them gives businesses a competitive advantage to actually, position them as a socially and environmentally responsible businesses, which helps them attract more customers, employees, investors, who are actually increasingly looking for such companies that are committed to sustainable development, particularly if you see the younger population, which is joining the workforce, as well as the consumers. I mean, joining the consumer force. And then access to finance. A lot of our businesses are recognizing now that they have a new source of finance by demonstrating their commitments towards sustainable development, through whether it is through pure impact investors or even through the responsible investors who are commercially focused, but they want a good balance between the two, you know, impact as well as returns. So, and then there is a huge stakeholder pressure which is coming up to these businesses from stakeholders like, you know, customers, employees, investors, communities, regulators, to actually adopt and contribute towards sustainable development. And lastly, you know, our businesses are part of the global community. So we are, an adoption of SDGs is a global trend. So Indian businesses are, you know, no more exception, or they have to align to the strategies of global standards. They have to, you know, work with them. So those are probably some of the factors that I could feel are driving sustainable development amongst us in India.
That's great, Smita. That's a great work. Making an organization aware and making them work towards SDG is definitely a big thing. And one more big thing that is making, which is important for them, is to digitize them. And that work is getting done by NeoITO, so which has taken the a pledge to digitize a lot of companies to help them. So, so Faiz, we need to understand from you, how has the need for digitization has changed or increased in the last few years? Which are the focus areas of the ecosystem, like apps, increasing optimization, traffic, increasing the traffic? So what do you think about the, how the digitization has changed in the last few years?
Yeah, so first of all, thank you for the opportunity and, you know, welcome to all the panelists. So, I mean, we live in an age where the large enterprises, they continue to innovate and they add value to their customers through their journey in the digitization and the digital transformation scope, right? But then suddenly we have the pandemic hit on us. And the great thing about this pandemic in a positive way was we were introduced in a realm of uncertainty, like exactly how the world is going to proceed further. And this was a point where many of the small enterprises, they had the option to continue their operations, but they had to embrace technology. So not necessarily digital transformation on an end-to-end, but at least digitization of their existing operations. So that led to a mass adoption in terms of many organizations, small startups, adopt digitization for their own existence. And that is the acceleration that we saw in that 1 year. Now, what has that digitization led to? It has led to many small enterprises enter the bandwagon of digital transformation, right? Where now they partner with other digital companies for the last mile delivery and so forth. Now, this has introduced a culture shift in all of us in terms of the amount of data that we consume, the number of apps that we consume on a daily basis. And our requirements have actually changed in terms of the internet speed, faster devices, etc. We are also talking about online education, right? So we are talking about healthcare, we are talking about finance. Every industry is getting, was impacted in terms of getting those digital upfronts. And we are also talking about AI and robotics replacing repetitive, dangerous, and dirty jobs as well. So there's a multiple use case of digitization, digital transformation that has actually impacted. And now we look at the important area of traffic and data management, the right tools in terms of data usage measurement, analyze this large amount of data and come up with business intelligence tools and so forth. So yeah, I mean, there's a lot of infrastructure development that's not happening in this world, especially in the Web3 sector as well. We also talk about distributed computing. We also talk about the quantum computing that's on the foresight. And let's not forget the very recent ChatGPT and regenerative AI. So now we are talking about like the entire landscape of enterprises, right? From startup, SMEs who are restrictive before, and large enterprises enabling and embracing technology very fast. So that's a lot of opportunity.
And if you talk about the digital world, communication with the customer also have increased a lot. And again, it has become more important. And that's why we have so many big players entering into this communication market. And so in this verse, we want to ask Abhishek. So when we have so many big players in the market, communication, selling the communication solution is a task. So what are strategies you use to position your startup, your product among the market giants?
Thank you. Look, what has happened in the recent past, that there have been a series of regulatory changes driven by TRAI. And there has been a series of ups and downs in the CPaaS market. Okay. The most important aspect of CPaaS market is it enables the last mile informational connectivity with the customer. Okay. Now, we may all think that SMSs keep on bothering us, right? But when we have to catch our flight and we don't know which flight we have to catch, the first thing we do is open our SMS inbox and see, you know, the flight guy would have sent me the SMS at least. And that is where we pick it up. The second most important is try and think of removing OTP for a single day from your life. And try and imagine what all things you will not be able to do if you don't have an SMS OTP working on your phone for the whole day, right? You will not be able to log in. You will not be able to do banking transactions. You will not be able to do e-commerce transactions. So much so that if you're living in a society and other apps are installed there, you will not be able to approve visitor entry, social media, all these things which are we are unable to do. So this is a very specialized market. In this year, the market was at a high in about April, March, right? Since then, we have seen a series of competitive edges coming out from all sides, which include pricing, which include product, which include alternative ways of doing business. So today, right now, what's happening is large players are already embedded in a large way in some of the most important customers. However, what we have been able to do is we've been able to sell our services primarily on our ability to service the accounts, our ability to understand customer problems and give them a design solution as to how this will impact your operations. And third thing, obviously, is understanding the impact of pricing and innovative pricing in this whole game. So at the end of the day, if you are willing to play a bet, you might want to keep your costs low or pricing low for a new startup customer, and then make sure that you are deeply integrated with them right from the beginning. And so that later on, even if somebody is trying to cut the price or kind of take away your customer, it is difficult for your customer to move away. So service, constant customer connect, and innovative pricing. These are three things that we have seen. They work a lot in terms of differentiating yourself in a competitive market space. Yeah.
That's great input, Abhishek. So ability to understand and making your customer understand the impact, I think, was the key in standing with the marketplace. With this, we come to the end of episode one of our discussion on how Indian tech startups are transforming the landscape. Our conversation with Smita, Prem, Faiz, and Abhishek will continue. So stay tuned for the part two of the discussion next week, where we will talk more about the key issues and the strategies in India, the change in the market during pre and post COVID era, and also the future of the CRM market. Please do like, share, and subscribe to the NASSCOM Community and Insights YouTube channel. Till then, it's goodbye from everyone here at NASSCOM Insights.